Well, I'm delighted to be here and talking about data. It's my job as a nerd to make data exciting and engaging and practical and real. And I know that that's kind of the balancing act, because people think of this as a technical subject. And because it's buried in academia, that's where the theory comes from, there's rigor. But in practice, what draws so many of us to the social sector is making a difference. And that way, software and data are a tool for making a difference. They're not an end in themselves. And my goal during this session is to riff off of an article I wrote for SSIR based on giving the keynote at the opening conference. And then I said, I gotta write that down. But it's to make it practical in terms of day-to-day, both with examples from my organization and other organizations. We're gonna have some small group work where I hope you guys get to explore some of this and meet each other. You know, maybe not the people you already know, which of course is the real point of coming to a conference like this. And so I'm kind of excited. Now my background is I'm an engineer, an entrepreneur. I was a regular Silicon Valley entrepreneur. You know, sort of the joke was I started 7 for-profit high-tech companies and only 5 failed. But the reason I got drawn into the nonprofit sector was that my venture capitalists, you know, Kleiner Perkins et al., vetoed a project to help people with disabilities at my first successful for-profit startup. And I wanted to do it anyway. So that was sort of the genesis of what Benetech is today, a nonprofit that is a tech company. You know, it's 80 people, but instead of doing one product, which is what a Silicon Valley software company is doing, we're doing 12. Because it's the nonprofit sector and everything is kind of small and balkanized and doesn't, you know, isn't gonna make you a lot of money. So I think that a lot of my career, my passion, is I see what Silicon Valley can do. I can see the technology, the products, the capabilities, the business models, and they're all there making lots of money. And if they're not making a lot of money, they get shut down. That's what makes Silicon Valley so incredibly effective as an incubator and scaler of tech companies. But almost every one of those tech and business model innovations, the use of data, could be applied to working on society's biggest problems. And guess what? Since most of Silicon Valley is working on the 5% richest, our market is 20 times larger than what Silicon Valley is working on. It's just not as much money. And so I think this is where I think we have to focus on, instead of maximizing profit, maximizing impact, maximize effectiveness. The world's problems are getting more and more complex. In many cases, the challenges on the other side that create these problems are increasingly sophisticated and using technology and data. And I think some of you guys can just kind of imagine where you could go with that. And so what I want to do is put this into practice, is how do we raise the game in practical terms that actually allow the nonprofit sector to succeed in its objective of serving communities in need around the world. Okay, so one of the basics parts of this is sort of software for good. How do we actually use the same software or similar kinds of software that business uses to become so much more profitable and effective? How do we use it to actually accomplish social good, right? And you know, you want efficiency, you want effectiveness, you want scalability. I'm gonna work in revolutionary change a little bit here as well, if you could be doing this. And so some of these technologies are the same technologies that everybody uses in business, right? Google's search engine is just as useful for people who work in human rights as it is in people who work in mortgage banking, right? And WhatsApp, which is, you know, a messaging app and has all sorts of cool things, and people use it to connect with each other, the social sector applications of WhatsApp are amazing because, frankly, many of the people that we want to serve are using WhatsApp, and imagine, you could have a global toll-free number on WhatsApp. I mean, this would be, should you be setting up a toll-free phone bank anymore? I don't know, think about that. So we have the off-the-shelf tools, and much of Silicon Valley is engaged in trying to make their software available for free or for less, or their services available, and that's great. But there is a point where the standard off-the-shelf solution stops, where Salesforce or something like that, that you might adapt your thing, it only gets you so far. There is a bunch of stuff that has to do with something we do in the social sector that is not the same thing as construction, for example. So you know, we ended up writing an app for environmentalists to manage projects. There are 50 project management apps in construction. None of them were a particularly good fit for planning a campaign to keep your community from building an incinerator or planning a wetlands restoration. So there's something about this need. And a lot of what I'm going to be talking about is that part of the social sector around communities in need, their needs, that aren't served so well by the off-the-shelf tools, the stuff that actually gets to the heart of what so many of our organizations actually do. And so I'll just give you kind of different examples. Some of these just make your project more effective. You know, if I can make my staff 10% more effective, that has big impact on my organization. If I can do that for 1,000 NGOs, you know, the return on investing $2 million in that application or technology that might save the sector $100 million, that's pretty good return on investment. There are also revolutionary opportunities where a tech and software venture actually completely changes a field, right? Now, we're familiar with this. This is what Silicon Valley is trying to get. Those are what unicorns, as we call them here. You know, Airbnb, it's a software company. You might think it's about renting hotel rooms or a room in someone's house. It's a software company. eBay, it's a software company, right? Uber, it's a software company. And this whole concept of how can you use software and data to completely reinvent a sector and be 10 times more cost effective, people go, oh, that's hard to do. So much of what the nonprofit sector does is push around information, right? These opportunities are out there. And I'll just pick the one example, which you might not think is a natural place, but disabled kids, people who are blind, people who are dyslexic, people who have a traumatic brain injury, a vet returning from war who's trying to go back to community college and doesn't read or think as well as he did before he was blown up by an IED. This is a need, and the way that we used to deal with it is we read to people, right? Then we made character recognition, we used machine learning, so that blind and dyslexic people could scan their own books. Our goal with our Bookshare project was reinvent the traditional library for the blind. Again, all software and data. So don't ship anything through the mail. You know, our largest competitor still ships cassette tapes through the postal service. So being 10 times more cost effective may be easier than you might otherwise think. Use e-books rather than human narrated books. Use crowdsourcing. Look at the community to scan all the books instead of us doing it. And our cost advantage is like 20x. And because it's a digital service, we collect data out our ears in terms of, if you do a digital service, you have to try hard not to collect data, right? And so now we have solved, instead of 5% of a social problem, we've actually solved 90% of the problem with a less than 5% of the budget money that was being spent on that problem. These opportunities exist, both to make the whole sector better with a 10x kind of return, or to pick off a single sort of issue. So think of that as both evolution and revolution. Technology enables this in business. It should be doing the same thing in our sector. Now, as we sort of approach these issues, I want to point out that people have this sort of vision of computers as the oracle, as the ones that are going to give us the answer. And I use this quote in my SSIR article on data. It's, computers are as dumb as bricks, right? And I mean, Julia Angwing gave us a great example of people thought that a computer would tell you better whether someone is going to reoffend than a human expert. But no one ever actually tested that. It turns out they were wrong. So you actually can't simply believe that because we've applied software and data to it, that miraculously now the answer is here. Because computers are really dumb. They do what programmers tell them to do. They process the data they have, and the algorithms that you use determine in many cases the outcome and whether or not that outcome is actually the one you wanted. So I just keep emphasizing that the goal of all this technology is to make smart people smarter, basically. How do we act? This is a tool, and this is going to allow you to get insights in how you're actually going to do what you want to do better. But you can't suddenly check your brain at the door and expect the computers, the data, the big data to suddenly give you the answer, because in many cases, it may be that the answer it gives is technically correct, but actually not actually correct on the ground in terms of the outcome that you want. So keep that in mind. Now, So I wrote this article, Data for Action and for Impact, and it's on the SSIR website, and they were kind enough to make it an open thing. You should subscribe to SSIR, but just in case you don't, you can also get your hands on it. And I think I want to talk about sort of the duality of data, that it's good for multiple things, assuming that you do the ethical things that Lucy talked about, you know, in the opening session. People use data to take action. Someone walks in the door of a nonprofit and they have probably a bunch of needs. And you are asking questions of that person to try to answer their needs. And in some cases, your organization has the answer. They need one thing, and that's what you provide. And now you're asking questions so that you can actually do what you actually want to do, what you are actually good at, right? In other cases, you may not be able to help that person, and you're actually trying to connect them with resources that they might have. In some cases, you're actually trying to analyze how effective is my team, right? If I have 5 branch offices around the state, and this office accomplishes 1/3 as much as every other office, you know, smart people smarter, the answer might be your manager there is really ineffective at actually motivating their team to do a great job. Or it could be that's the one heavily rural part of the state where the population is small, it's really distributed, and since your people are driving around, they're just, you know. So again, you have to actually go the extra level and say, what does this data tell me? But frankly, a lot of people are using data to actually understand how to run their organization better, right? One of the other things that we all do, we invent great solutions, we create great services. We believe that we can help people, but if nobody knows about what you do, they're not going to actually take advantage of that, and it's going to have been a potential social good as opposed to a realized social good. And so, you know, frankly, we don't use the term sales and marketing in the nonprofit sector. We call it outreach, or whatever you want, you know, whatever the socially acceptable term is, but there are great data tools to actually do this. And a lot of people don't know that Google gives away free ads to 501c3s who apply and meet some basic requirements. My organization gets $500,000 per year of free Google advertising. And why is it? Because our biggest project delivers books to kids with disabilities for free. Our promise is, if you're dyslexic or blind and you need a book for school, we'll get it to you, you know, in 60 seconds if we already have it. We have 500,000 books already. And if we don't already have it, we'll go buy a book, chop it, scan it, proofread it, stick it in our book. So that's our solution. But it doesn't make any impact if no one gets it. Google allows us to have someone to measure whether someone goes all the way from finding us online, often through a search engine or coming from another resource, and track them all the way to, did they complete the sign up for our free service? Between 500 and 1,000 students sign up every month for our service through a channel that we measure through Google, right? And that's actually why Google gives us $500,000 a year free advertising rather than $100,000 a year, is because we do that complete analysis to actually say this. And of course, you know, what is this using data for? This is about helping kids with disabilities get what they need. So many of what the groups that you are, or that you support, or consult with, or fund, have a problem that looks almost identical to the problem I just described, and yet, I'm gonna guess 90% of them are not taking advantage of this resource. And yet, if you think about who are the parents of the kids that you're trying to serve, the person who's in the library, who's trying to find a job, they may well stumble across your thing if you make it easier for them to find, because they may not know about you. You know, data for program design. How could we actually do a better job of actually executing our product? You know, maybe we have 3 aspects of our service. Is there a way we could measure how effective these different components are? And of course, if we find out that one of them isn't all that effective, or is like, you know, gives us a tenth as much bang for the buck, maybe we should double down on the first two, or maybe we should experiment with a third that is different than the one that we've been doing for 25 years, because it was a great idea back in the 80s, but now maybe there's a better way of doing it. So we're gonna come back to data for referrals, because I think that this is really, I think this is an exciting area, and we're gonna have a small group dive in, and I think referrals is so common to so many nonprofit sectors, it's a good one to experiment with. But we also have, you know, data for cost understanding, right? You know, no startup in Silicon Valley gets very far without having a really good idea of what it costs them to acquire each new customer and what it costs them to serve each customer. Because they're all trying to now, when they're spending $1 million a month, justify how if they only, you know, if they were spending $10 million a month, they would be profitable, right? They have to have this detailed cost understanding. Many nonprofits don't have a great cost understanding and don't really understand, for example, that these 10% of our clients actually suck half of our budget and have the worst outcomes. That might actually be, you know, that might actually be a call to action if you knew that. And so, and this is, so this is all, this is not about data for your donors, though your donors may be interested in this. This is data for you. And the thing that ultimately I say, imagine that you're the program manager, right? And he or she who's running that program, what does he or she need to know to be successful in their role, in what they're committed to doing, what their team is trying to accomplish? Get the software and the data that gives them the information to do their job better. And everything else we're going to talk about will flow, all these good things will flow from that core thing. But if you take a data mandate from a big funder and you force the frontline staff to do something that doesn't seem to be at all connected to the work they're doing on a day-to-day basis, they are going to resist that like you would not believe. Do I spend, you know, the next 2 hours filling out reports that are useless, or do I serve two more clients, right? And the more that we make people who are working for less money for mission goals do stuff that is unrelated to why they're there, the more frustrated they're going to be and the more turnover we're going to have. And, you know, so these things actually have really good impacts. So, but impact is why we're here. Both short-term impact, you know, did we house this person so they are no longer on the street? Did we cure this infectious disease so that they are no longer infectious? You know, did we get this kid back in school rather than being, you know, suspended? There are these things that are short-term impacts that are, you know, not long-term impact. You know, did this lead long-term to a life of health or better economic empowerment or better educational attainment that led to a better job? But these are the things that many of us came into the field to make a difference, make a lasting difference. That's impact. And that's what most donors are actually looking for. And of course, many of us are experiencing donors that are holding us to higher and higher standards. You know, how did a dollar given to you lead to more salmon? Or fewer women being domestically abused? Or what, you know, whatever the criteria is, there's usually a motivation there, a motivation that we almost all share, the mission, but we actually have to make that story. And I get a lot of nonprofit CEOs come to us and say, because this is a lot of what we end up doing, you know, along the way of building things, we kind of like CTO for an hour, come and confess your data and software sins to us and we'll try to help you with that, right? And people are in a lot of pain about this. And so, you know, how do we actually make this connection to long-term impact in a way that actually, I don't know, justifies what the donors are actually going to do. So I'll try to connect this up. So let me give you one other frame, and this is a frame that I think is a helpful one. Is usually if you're at the policymaker or donor level, especially if you're at the big donor level, you know, federal government agencies, assuming that they're still making grants in the future, or you know, international organizations, you know, they have a big picture frame of what they're doing. And the distance between, let's say, the Sustainable Development Goals and your particular program intervention is often a great distance. But that is the frame that the donors are thinking about. You know, did we decrease, you know, hunger? You know, did we increase girls' educational engagement measured with these indicators? So many of the programs that we have these connections. And one of the things, and just recaptured a thread there, you know, one of the things that people come to me and say, Jim, how is big data going to help my organization? And I ask, so what data are you collecting? And the answer is, well, once every 3 years, we do a big survey at the end of our major grant. Big data is not going to help you very much because you actually need to be collecting data all along the way. And those things for action, will throw off data trails that we can use for impact. So let me make this real, because I think a lot of this stuff sounds very ethereal. So, you know, data for action and data for impact, it's the holy grail. But let me give you a human rights example and a youth development example that, to kind of make this real. So the human rights example is one of our programs is we develop software for human rights groups to collect human rights violation data confidentially and securely. So the idea is all human rights groups, you know, once they get past sort of doing victim services or survivor services, they start realizing we want to work on the root cause. The only asset they have, other than their staff and activists, is the information, the stories of suffering that are experienced by people who have experienced sexual violence or racial or religious discrimination or a wide variety of things. So to pick an example, and of course, why do we do this? It's often, in the human rights field, a very long slog from working on this problem to actually seeing national policy change or seeing social attitudes change, right? And so human rights is a long game. But you should have a theory of what it is that you're doing that beyond just sort of reacting to the crisis is actually going to help decrease the likelihood that more and more people are going to experience the same bad things that the people you're working with experience. So we work with lesbian and gay groups in Africa. And of course, they're experiencing different questions than whether they can go to a certain bathroom or whether they get married. They're facing very existential threats, you know, and when they're outed, they lose their housing, they lose access to healthcare, education. It's a very serious issue that they experience. And one of the issues they experience is abuse by police, right? That if a gay person is beaten up, they're more likely to be arrested than the three people who beat them up, right? And so we worked with a network of LGBT groups in Malawi, and they took hundreds of stories and they built the first ever national report on police violence against members of the community in Malawi. Now, they had, you know, low expectations that this would lead to change, but they figured at least let's put the data on the map and bring it to the attention. Now, Malawi has a former British kind of colonial structure. There's an inspector general of the police. And when the inspector general of the police read this report, he said, this is not what our police are supposed to be doing. These are citizens of our country, and when they experience a crime, we should prosecute the people who are the perpetrators of that crime rather than abusing or ignoring our citizen, right? And so he gathered the LGBT national leaders together with all the provincial police chiefs and made the provincial police chiefs give out their mobile numbers, their personal mobile numbers, to all the activists and said, if you run into a problem, you should call the regional police. And then if he or she doesn't do something, you should contact me as the inspector general and I will do something. And suddenly there was a shift where there started to be prosecutions of people who, you know, were experiencing, you know, were perpetrators of hate crimes as opposed to victims, so or survivors. So it's a, you know, this is what we live for. Frankly, it happens far too rarely. So we really celebrate the examples. But there's an action of the data for action was data collected in delivering services to people who had been beaten up, who had lost housing, meeting their immediate needs, but capturing their stories so you could do this larger report and influence national policy change, and actually that leading to actual behavior change in the institutions of the state. That is the dream of the human rights movement in a nutshell. And whatever the challenges we face, we have to keep plugging away at that. So now let me give you a more practical example where I actually served as an advisor to this project rather than being involved with it, but it is the coolest darn project you could imagine. So many of you are working in youth development, right? And the dream of youth development is we take this 12-year-old immigrant girl or African-American boy, we intervene, we do this program, we bring them to a charter school, go to the Boys and Girls Club, and they get this. And they graduate from college and get a middle-class income, right? That's the dream. And making the direct connection between the kid I talked to at 12, or did something for at 12, and what happened to that kid at 22, you know, imagine designing that randomized control trial. It's going to be pretty pricey. But this is where data comes in. This is where the secret of big data is not always collecting the data yourself. It's having access to these giant data stores. Who has the biggest database of basically economic, especially white collar, and educational attainment. It's called LinkedIn, right? And why do people get into LinkedIn? Because that's where you get a job, if you're a white collar worker especially. It's where you recruit for jobs. So there's this incentive for people to sign up for LinkedIn and maintain their data, so which is like the biggest issue you can imagine is, how can I get good data? Well, here's a whole bunch. They're all keeping the data really in great shape for another reason. LinkedIn went to Boys and Girls Club, KIPP schools, Beyond 12, which is a great program for keeping minority populations who get into college, actually having them succeed in college. They sign up their students, especially if they're high school or college students. They sign up their alums, if they're KIPP, because KIPP, I think right now, ends at grade 8. And LinkedIn does a data analysis where the fact that you went to the Boys and Girls Club of Newark is not on your profile, but LinkedIn has that data, and they can do an aggregate analysis of everyone who went through this program 5 years ago. What college did they graduate from, or whatever the issue might be? So now here we are. This is data we could not possibly collect as the social sector, but actually starts giving us some insights. And it's not easy. Frankly, I think LinkedIn had a dozen groups participate in this, and only 3 or 4 are actually sticking with it because it's hard to get people to sign up. We do know what LinkedIn's economic interest is. It's like a lot of companies, start them young, right? But it's not exactly using the data to target them for something nefarious. It's, you know, to target them for better jobs, right? So this is not necessarily incompatible with our thing. And informed consent, which actually for minors is an issue, right? But anyway, you work through those things. And so, you know, we will know the outcome of this experiment over a longer period of time. But conceptually, we should start thinking about how the data that so much of Silicon Valley, as Julia said, there's, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars have been made off of your data collectively. How do we actually use that for social good? So now that we've kind of got a handle on that, I want to actually start giving you a specific example. We're going to go into our small groups and then dive into this. And so the setup here is not necessarily ideal for small groups, but I have scoped out some of the chairs actually do move, or pairs of them move. And I promise the organizers I will go back and realign all the chairs afterwards, right after our session. But start thinking about how you might get together in a group of 8 or 9. And we're going to tackle a specific problem. And the problem I want to tackle is the social sector referral issue, right? Half the time when I talk to ED of a nonprofit here in the United States, and they describe the tech need that they have that they're suffering with, referral is in it at least half the time, right? Someone walks in the door of the social sector and they have a complex set of needs. And the odds that my organization can solve all of them is really low. So what can I do to actually be helpful to them when I can't do that? So that's the problem that we're going to deal with. And one of the interesting things about referral is people think it's about writing the software or building the database. It's actually much more about how the organizations in this ecosystem that might potentially work together, how they're actually going to share data and how that data sharing is actually useful. So I want you to keep thinking about the practical aspect of this rather than the, we're going to build the great database in the sky. So I want you, when you're in your small groups, to start thinking, I'm the legal aid person. I'm the person who finds housing. I'm the person who signs someone up for Medicaid or Obamacare or whatever comes next. I'm the person who does mental health, whatever these different roles are. Maybe I'm the donor who wants to see all the groups that do homelessness in our community work together to actually end homelessness in our community. I can tell you that the groups that are trying to end homelessness completely in their community, they have a data and a software problem that is very focused on attaining zero persistent homelessness and zero veteran homelessness. How could we might do that? So, but when you get into your small groups, and I will run around and help organize this, and Joel from Benetech will also help me do this. So, you should spend the first 30, 45 seconds introducing yourself and what you do, because there is an amazing group of people here, and it would be great if you sat with people that you don't know really well, because that's what we all tend to do, sit with a group of people you don't know as well, and hear a little bit of what they do, so that you've at least got a placeholder for something you're gonna track down during the sessions. And dig in. Imagine what the data for action and the impact might be, and then we're going to actually answer a few questions, get some learnings. Joel's been handing out a piece of paper in terms of the rubric, and so let's see if I can find that piece of paper. There we go. Okay, so here's our problem, and I'll leave this up on you. A client seeks help for 7 needs. You can help with 3. What's your data for action? What data do you need to help with the 3 things that you might actually do at a typical social service agency? You know, you're Asian Americans for community involvement here in San Jose. You know, you have a number of programs, so you can do some of them, but you don't do all of them. So what do you need to do that? What's your data for impact? Okay, Sunlight Giving or someone like that who's a big tech philanthropy wants to help the people you want to help. You have to make a case to them on why the work that you're doing actually justifies a 6-figure grant. So, and of course, it also could be you justifying to your board and your staff why what you're doing has long-term impact, right? These work. And then how do you go about getting this data, and how do you do that in a way that meets some of the values-based criteria that we use in the social sector? Because we often are, somewhat more constrained than what Silicon Valley would do with your data, because we have values that actually connect to autonomy and privacy and other things. So now let's go ahead and find those groups. In some cases, the chairs are all tied together. In some cases, two of them are tied together, and you can actually move them around. Hang out. I will get going on this, and let's solve the referral problem. Let's figure it out. Okay, everybody, I know that your conversations are incredibly engaging and that they would go on indefinitely if we actually gave you some scope. But we are also almost at the end of the time, and I've gotten the organizers to give us an extra couple of minutes to actually hear some of the pithy insights. So don't do the obvious stuff. Don't do a full report back because we're already at time. Just what did you guys go like, wow, that was cool, or people ought to know this, or we did it this way and we thought that worked great. And so we're going to bring around the mics, and so I don't know, who here kind of got tapped to kind of say anything? Here, grab the mic. Okay.
The one thing that was very important was around data sharing in communities and having agreements that are friendly enough for people to feel comfortable that they can sign them, but how do you ensure that as you learn more and need to change the agreement in order to support cross-organizational learnings that you allow for that to happen?
Yeah, data governance, big issue when you're dealing with vulnerable populations. Joel, and please introduce yourself and then.
Wow, she wasn't kidding about that sunlight. Hi, I'm Lily. Our conversation went in a lot of different directions. Sorry for having my back to you guys. We've ended up focusing a bit on the importance of a data of culture, which I think is a different session that's happening right now. And I think distilling the conversation, one of the big things that we uncovered is, what's the question you're trying to answer? Like, what are you trying to solve for in order to be able to then get to the data that is really important, especially with organizations that are trying to solve huge, huge, huge problems like childhood education. Wow. How do you get to a very pointed question and then deconstruct that to be able to figure out the data required, the data available, the data needed, et cetera, et cetera?
Cool. Great. Please.
Is this thing on? Oh, there we go. Hi, everyone. I'm Julia. I think we kind of focused on 2 different areas in our groups, didn't get to a lot of the questions, but thought about 2 different challenges related to the, there's 7 needs and you have 3 ways to do things. One was the data sharing needs. So, if you can connect someone to another organization that will meet those unmet 4 needs, how do you facilitate data sharing? Who has the responsibility for that? What are some of the kind of security implications and how do those structures get built? We had a lot of interesting thought experiment conversations, not as many decisions made. And then the other way we thought about things is taking things one step backwards, which is, if you're an organization that can help with 3 needs, do you even know who to refer to, who can help with the other 4 needs? So great if you know, and the challenge you're facing is how do you share information? But if you take it one step backwards, how do you know who can do those things?
Yeah.
And who bears responsibility for maintaining that view across a sector or across a geography? And, is there a role foundations play there in being the you know, holders of information, how do they convene nonprofits working in similar spaces? So a lot of interesting conversation.
So thank you for that softball. It so happens that at this conference is the country's number one expert in answering that question, Greg Bloom of openreferral.org. Greg, are you still around here? He was wandering around here a second ago. Anyway, he'll be in the next session in this room right after lunch. So definitely check it out. This is one of the reasons is we're really interested in exploring this issue because we think it affects all sorts of parts of the social sector and so many communities. Okay, we have the mic here.
Hi, I'm Deirdre McKee. Our group jumped right into the intake interview, basically, for the person walking in. We thought a lot about self-report data that we needed to collect from the person coming into our social service organization. And then I'll just say, I think our major highlight was that we realized we were going to engage with people over a period of time, and so we needed channels of communication. That we really needed to know how we were going to stay in touch with that person so we could certainly get information in the first place and then look at impact later.
Cool. Great. Please.
All right. We had a lot of interesting ideas and discussion. It's hard to pick just one. But one concept that we kind of talked about was this concept of self-ownership of data and access to my own data. So if I need a referral, why do I have to rely on consenting to my doctor to share data with my specialist that I have an appointment with next week? Why don't I have access to exactly what my doctor recorded on me, and then I can decide, yes, I can easily share this with the specialist that I need to see? So that,
wow.
That was one
That's
interesting
awesome.
Topic.
Yeah. Great, thank you. All right, please.
I'll start this way. I think one of the main things we talked about was the burden of getting that data from the intake process. And who does that? And if you know at a certain point that your organization doesn't fulfill that need, you know, when can you pass that on? And does the next organization take on that burden of collecting the information? We did not have a lot of answers, but we had some great conversations around that.
Awesome. Please, have we figured out who's going to speak on behalf of this group? Thank you.
I guess I am. Our conversation was similar to the group over there where we talked about a referral database that this agency has that a lot of different agencies all put the data in, and then we talked about who becomes ultimately responsible for managing mm-hmm. the case or managing the family and what the different challenges that leads to. And that's about as far as we got, really.
Okay, great, thank you. Next team, great.
Yeah, I think in this group, we all had a shared vision for what such a system could look like. The ultimate question ended up being, what's the motivation for getting such a system sparked? One idea was a funder mandate, that a funder will only fund in a particular area if certain conditions are met for these agencies to cooperate with each other. Another idea was, is there some kind of ROI incentive or maybe an incentive around we are able to serve better, more patients or more clients if we're able to kind of meet the whole client's needs and thereby reduce return visits or recidivism or issues of that sort.
Great. And Anthony?
Yes, we looked at the seven needs and asked ourselves, you know, of those seven needs, you know, and trying to identify the three, which three, you know, are connected in some way that and which three that, you know, do we have data around to help inform our work? And then from, you know, as we started talking about conversations and other things that, you know, privy, you know, close to our work, there was discussion around, you know, the importance of foundations. I work at a foundation to really invest in nonprofits' kind of organizational capacity to manage data, collect data, and use it to better their work, right? So it's one thing to ask for data, but what does that mean to an organization that maybe have an executive director, a program person, and just don't have the resources to really do their jobs well?
All right, awesome. And I think this is our last group, right? Okay.
Actually, we heard from three groups who actually provide social services and talked to them about the challenges that they face. So one of those was mentioned by another group, just identifying the theory of impact and knowing and letting that guide your choice of data. But we also heard from a group that is very concerned about privacy because they have very sensitive data on immigration, domestic violence, yeah. et cetera. And so knowing how to interact with other organizations, one of the first things you have to do is figure out what of that you can share, how do you share it, knowing that it's extremely sensitive data. Another challenge that groups faced was the contribution versus attribution problem. Mm-hmm. So when you've got multiple organizations who are all doing the right thing and coming together to provide wraparound services, how do you think about figuring out how that contribution, how the effect of that should be attributed? And then finally, we also talked a little bit about data alignment. So we heard from one group, a church that is working to improve literacy. They've got test scores that are presented in one way and a set of recommendations that tell you to respond using a different data measure. So they're trying to figure out, like, you know, we've got all the data, we've got the energy, we've got the intervention. How do we make the data line up?
Yeah.
So those are a few of the things that we talked about.
All right. Well, I wanted to thank you guys all for digging in. This was meaty. Hopefully you met some very cool people who are also interested in data for good and for impact. And feel free to come and ask me questions or Joel. We would love to do more in this area and support Greg Bloom and his vision of a much more robust open source referral infrastructure. And so we'll see if we can make a common good in that area. Thanks a lot, everybody.